Also, while we are paused, can you guys see this bar up here?
No, I don't see a bar. I say we all live in a watershed is the top line.
Okay, perfect. I was like, I wonder if they can even see the title because it's blocking that. But yeah, so as I was saying, we all live in a watershed that contributes to somewhere downstream, whether it's a river or a creek or the ocean. So we can all have a positive effect on reducing pollution into our waterways. This is also important because 40% of our water supply in California actually comes from our groundwater. I think we have this narrative that all of our water is trucked in from somewhere else, but a good amount of it is from our own groundwater supply and recycled water. And this is a diagram of a natural watershed. So when rain is intercepted by things like trees and other leafy plants, it flows down their leaves and their stems, and it gets absorbed by roots, continues down to the sediment, and percolates down to our water table, overflows into rivers, creeks, wetlands. And at every step of the way, it's filtered, it's slowed down, and it has a chance to absorb and be utilized by plants and animals. And then if we look at an average residential area, it does not look like that diagram, because we have a large portion of the footprint of this property is taken up by the roof. And the whole point of the roof is to keep water out of your house, obviously. So the water slides down to the gutters or just off of the gutters and is usually routed to a downspout at the corner. And this is often put straight out onto a paved driveway that leads directly out past a paved sidewalk into the gutters and onto the street. And if we look at the rest of this house, we see compacted turf, we see unmulched areas, and we see more of these impermeable pathways. So after the water reaches the street, it starts collecting pollution on its way of wherever it's going. So we can see trash, plastic pollution, animal waste, maybe there's some dog poop or bird poop. And there's also pollution that we can't see as easily. So there's oil, toxic brake pad and tire dust that builds up on the street. There's dirt that's blown off during the course of maintenance, spilled fuel, and chemicals like herbicides, fertilizers, and pesticides, all which just accumulate on the street and then get flushed down the watershed with each rain event. The bulk of this happens during the first 1 or 2 inches of rain in what is usually called the first flush. This water heads to storm drains and gets dumped into flood control systems, where most of these flood control systems were previously creeks, rivers, and these like slow winding pathways that would allow water to soak into the soil, be filtered by plants, and have time to soak down into the ground. But they've been replaced by these like straight shot channelized cement areas that just direct water away from urban areas as fast as possible. And this is especially a problem in older cities with combined sewer overflow systems or CSOs, where even just with a small amount of rain, even an eighth of an inch, it can send untreated sewage out into our waterways. So all of this goes out to our rivers, oceans, and beaches, where bacteria and chemical pollution from urban runoff can harm ocean visitors and wildlife. This is often why you will hear, don't go to the beach 3 days after it rains. And even when it doesn't rain, we still have sources of dry weather runoff. So sprinkler overspray, broken or leaking irrigation, and people purposely hosing down driveways, all of this contributes to the same kind of pollution that a natural rain event would cause. In Long Beach, we have an example for the Colorado Lagoon. The Colorado Lagoon at one point in time had about 12 storm drains draining into it. It is down to about 2 overflow ones, I believe. but they still get nutrient runoff and pollution that causes these algae blooms and red tides that cause harm to the organisms that live there and the people that like to swim and enjoy it. So how can our
garden society thing?
Oh, someone's excited. So how can our gardens help? They can reduce pollution at the source, so not providing these extra points of pollution, slowing the flow of water, soaking in rainwater before it becomes polluting runoff, and building climate resilience to counter sea level rise, increased storm intensity, and flooding. We can build healthy soil by promoting microorganisms, so not just spraying pesticides and herbicides everywhere that just kill everything in the ground. These microorganisms make little tunnels and burrows and spaces for water to collect. Organic material like worm castings and compost help trap pollutants much better than just sediment alone. And living soil absorbs more water than dry, hydrophobic soil. Soil also acts as an important carbon reserve for climate resilience. Soils store much more carbon than living animals and plants. And usually when we think about about carbon storage and carbon sequestration in forests, we're thinking about large trees, old growth forests, but the soils themselves also play a very important role in keeping carbon out of our atmosphere, because everything that dies, falls down, gets decomposed and added to soil layers where it's stored and trapped for long periods of time. We can also slow the flow of rain in our gardens by giving water a place to soak in, reducing hardscapes, so breaking up existing pavements, or if you're putting in a new pathway, using things like gravel or decomposed granite. Directing downspouts toward our plants and our planters instead of onto our driveways, and contouring with basins, bales, swales, and berms, and adding features like dry creeks and rain gardens that give water a place to kind of pool and collect and soak into the ground. You can also install rain barrels or cisterns if you want to keep rainwater on site and use it for later. And you might think we're in Southern California, it doesn't rain that much here, but a 1,000 square foot roof can generate 620 gallons of water for just 1 inch of rain. And then we can also use native and climate appropriate plants. So the long root systems hold water much better than the short roots that are on turf grass. And drought tolerant and regionally climate adapted plants don't promote the use of over irrigation and don't cause as much dry weather runoff. And it also obviously has the added benefit of increasing habitat and local biodiversity. And it doesn't promote the use of fertilizers, pesticides, and intensive maintenance. Even just one tree can prevent 1600 gallons of runoff from going into a storm drain. So if you're interested in participating in the Ocean Friendly Gardens program, or if you think you already have an ocean friendly garden in your yard, we would love to have you participate. You can scan this QR code on screen, or we can give you the link later. You can also head to our website for the Long Beach Surfrider, and you can fill out this form and we'll review it, and we can get you a yard sign, and you can add to our map that we're working on right now to inspire others, and then also have this nice sign in your yard to tell all your neighbors that you have an ocean-friendly garden. And the criteria is outlined in there. So it's things like making sure that you have at least 50% native plants in your yard. You're not using chemical fertilizers or pesticides. You have some kind of stormwater retention and some other things. And then we've been working with Dashboard Earth, the pilot program for this mobile app, to break down our Ocean Friendly Garden program into more accessible bite-sized actions. So for example, prompting people to plant a native plant, remove an invasive plant, and resources on how to do that, how to find those, and pledging to go chemical free, so not using fertilizers or pesticides, And part of this project, we're also doing 3 hands-on demonstration workshops in Long Beach. So if you're in the Long Beach area and interested in volunteering, helping turn some yards into ocean-friendly gardens, we would love to have you. If you know someone who would be interested in hosting a pilot project at their house and installing like a small rain garden feature, we're also looking for people to get involved that way. And if you'd like to check out the app, we're going to be adding some more cool things in it very soon. If you would like to download it, the QR code is here, and you can also just search Dashboard Earth in the App Store. And I'm going to leave this up while I hand it over to Kai, and Kai's going to do part 2 of this presentation. I'm going to stop sharing.
Thanks, Katie. And I think someone wanted the link for the Ocean Friendly Gardens page in the chat. And someone else also asked, do you know where that mural is with the giant bee and poppy?
Yeah, that's in Ventura. That was a community ocean friendly garden project. I am not sure of the exact location, but that was done by our previous like program lead. But yeah, it's somewhere in Ventura.
Okay.
It's a great.
Yeah, and I think some people missed your introduction. So if you could give a short, reason why you're, doing this today.
Sure. I am from Surfrider Foundation and their Southern California Ocean Friendly Gardens Coordinator. I have been involved in like wetlands restoration, and I recently graduated with a BS in marine biology from UC Santa Cruz. I'm really passionate about ocean conservation and botany and California native plants. And I'm working with Kai on building out our Long Beach Ocean Friendly Garden program and making our urban spaces more of green infrastructure. Yeah.
Thank you. And I'm just going to try to share my screen now. Let's see. Okay, can everybody see that?
Looking good.
Okay.
Maybe you should go full screen now.
Yeah, I was just trying to see how to do that. Okay, great. All right, so yeah, if you missed my intro previously, my name's Kai Craig. I'm the Ocean Friendly Gardens Coordinator for the Long Beach chapter of the Surfrider Foundation since 2017. I'm a local landscape designer and builder with my company, California Eco Design. And so that's been since 2010. I'm gonna share with you some strategies that Katie mentioned for capturing stormwater, storing stormwater. And so just if you look at that top left graph on the history of drought in California, so you can see that the area of drought and the intensity of drought, the frequency is just increasing over time with climate change. So when I started doing this, I started around the time when Long Beach was offering a rebate for converting your lawn to low water landscapes around 2010. So that was kind of the tail end of that drought period there. And so you can kind of see that in those intervening periods where we actually do get some rainfall, that's kind of our ideal period where, you know, it's really important to bank all of our stormwater. So that just kind of highlights the importance of that. And so it's a storage issue, right? Like we need, just like with solar panels or electricity, you need battery storage for when, you know, the power is not available with renewables. We need to bank our rainfall. And so recharging groundwater is one way we can do that in our gardens. But even, you know, not every, like here in Long Beach, a lot of, it may not be, you know, there's a number of clay layers between us and the groundwater. So our groundwater gets recharged up closer to the foothills of the mountains. But we need to, it's still valuable because we need to recharge our soil, right? Where plants can access that moisture. So on the bottom graph, you can see the kind of seasonal nature of our rainfall. So, you know, we get all our rain in the winter months and we have those dry summers. So that's when we need to recharge our soil and, you know, groundwater, if you can, to carry us through the dry periods, whether it's a long drought or just the summer. So I've broken down, you know, our stormwater strategies into kind of three stages. The capture phase, where we need to collect that rainwater, convey strategy, where we're moving that rainwater, and an infiltrate strategy to soak up the rainfall. Capturing the rain is largely going to depend on your strategy is going to depend if you have gutters or not. So if you have gutters or, you know, collecting water off your roof, you can collect it in the rain barrel or just a downspout. I kind of think of rain barrels as a temporary storage, just kind of a buffer. When you get a bunch of rain, you can hold it, you know, for a little while. But as Kathryn mentioned, it, you know, if you get an inch of rainfall on 1,000 square feet, you're getting 650 gallons, you know, rain barrels, it's like 55 gallons or so. So it's kind of a way to hold the, you know, first flush and direct it to another feature. Like in this picture, it's going to move on to like a dry creek. Rain chains are another nice way to kind of highlight the path of water, and they can diffuse some of the energy. A lot of times if it's just coming out of a downspout, it's just blasting out and it could just like wash away all the mulch, or and it just looks cool, right? Here's kind of a strategy we use in a situation where, you know, there's no gutter. So how do you get the water into, you know, maybe a basin or some other part of your yard? So this diagram is showing like a flow through planter, but really it could just be, you know, what we call French drain. This is a buried pipe with holes in it. You don't have to excavate all the dirt. What we did here in this planter on the right was we buried a pipe with gravel around it, and it's wrapped in landscape fabric. So it's basically like a French drain. So it can collect all the water, and then we can direct it outward, because you don't want the water to infiltrate like right at the, you know, right at the near your house. It's best to have it at least 5 feet away. So then moving into like a, you know, our strategy for conveying stormwater, there's the dry creeks. To move the water away, you want to have some slope to it. There's infiltration is going to happen in the dry creek, which is great, but they're kind of designed to reach a certain capacity, and then they're going to start, the water's going to move along. And if you look online, a lot of people will say that, you know, you'll see a lot of details that have a landscape fabric under the rock, and I don't advise using landscape fabric. I usually just put a 2-inch layer of sand beneath any stone. You know, landscape fabric will eventually silt up and water won't be able to get through. It'll deteriorate. It won't allow air to pass through. So the soil becomes dead and compacted, and it breaks down and kind of turns to trash, and it's a mess. So you're going to get weeds on there anyway, but at least with the sand, you know, once it's gone through 2 inches of sand and a couple inches of pebble, the weeds will be pretty easy to pull out. So that's what I recommend. And on the right, you can see kind of a picture with a lot of dry creeks running through the yard. And it was, you know, obviously that was Halloween, so it's just a couple of weeks ago. So you can kind of see it. But, you know, as the plants fill in, they become, you know, they blend in. Bioswales or vegetated swales are kind of a variation of that. They don't have to have rocks in them because plants will generally fill in anyway, so you don't have to buy a lot of expensive rock. On the right, you can see, you know, yarrow is kind of taking over the swale with some verbena and other plants. You know, the roots help keep the soil permeable, helps the infiltration. And, you know, when I amend soils with native, I usually use like a cactus mix. So it's just pretty lean on compost, but it does help kickstart the biology and help the permeability of it. I'm sure there's lots of opinions on that. So once you get it to a place where you want to infiltrate the stormwater, you know, rain gardens are a fantastic way. And it's kind of hard when you look on Google, you know, at rain garden planting design. You know, it's kind of a concept that began like in Maryland and the East Coast. So you'll see a lot of kind of just flowering perennials. So finding things that work with California native plants is kind of a trial and error and depends a lot on your soils and how long the water is going to stick around. But you know, you can see from this diagram, you have like the bottom zone of the rain garden is kind of the area where plants need to be very inundation tolerant. But we also want drought tolerant plants, right? For during the, you know, dry period. So we're talking about sedges and rushes primarily, like juncus and carex. And then you have the slope regions. I think I'll talk a little bit more about the plant selection later, but really just here we're talking about the topography and the landform, and what you're doing is excavating an area that's about 6 to 8 inches deep where the water can pond. You have an inlet. In this case, you can see like the planter in the background, that it's just a pipe comes from that planter. Or it can be the swale, and then you have an overflow somewhere for the water to exit if it gets too much. So that was that rain garden just 6 months ago. And you can see there's a top of the berm that has more of the dry, more shrubby adapted plants and then in the bottom are the inundation tolerant plants. And that's just in the last week or two. You can see it's, you know, grown quite a bit. So here's another strategy for if you have a slope where we're just using retaining walls to slow the runoff and allow the water to sink in. And you can kind of see on this diagram on the upper left that, you know, might show how the path of water would be diverted, or it's probably just going to hit that wall and hopefully sink down behind it. But it's really been beneficial for the plants. When we first planted this, while the larger shrubs were getting established, we seeded it with poppy seeds and lupine, and it was kind of that super bloom year. So we got this huge poppy explosion, and there were people like going into their yard to do, you know, selfies and stuff. It was pretty fun. But you can see that same garden now. So 2019 to 2022, has filled in quite a bit, and all the shrubs have gotten established. That's Canyon Prince, Creeping Wild Rye, and I think that looks like a Aster chilensis in the foreground. So here's another situation where stormwater management was really important. This area was all concrete, and the homeowner was actually getting, you can see the shadow of the roof on the right there. But it was getting flooded into their house. So we removed that concrete and built a retaining wall and dug out this basin. And then, you know, some of that excess soil was put behind the retaining wall. So we had like two levels. And so you put the upland shrubs on the upper part, and carex creeping red fescue on the lower for the meadow area or infiltration basin. And they haven't had any flooding since. And the final kind of real easy low-tech solution is just a berm around the perimeter of the property or the yard to kind of turn the whole yard into a stormwater capture area. So that works really well. You can see there's no gutter on the roof area there, and all the water is kind of just sheet flows and is already spread out. So instead of concentrating that runoff into one spot, we're just letting it kind of spread out over the landscape, and the berm contains it and lets it sink in. So those are kind of some examples. And here's just a few examples for the plant selection. So you have the kind of your tree, and this kind of goes back to the diagram that Kathryn was showing earlier, where for the watershed diagram, and like having this diverse structure where the trees are intercepting rainfall, the shrubs are intercepting rainfall, and it finally can collect in the basin. So those are just some plants that would work in the different zones there. For that. So yeah, that's our presentation, and thank you for letting me share those examples with you. There's some contact info at the bottom if anyone wants to get in touch. So I don't know Katie, if any questions came up. I kind of tore right through that, but if anyone, said you want to.
I didn't see anything in the chat, okay. But if anyone has any questions now,
yeah,
we'd be happy to answer them.
Well, how many of these ocean-friendly gardens are you guys assisting with the install on these days? I remember that back in the day there was, you know, you had some direct involvement with homeowners. Is that still a program? Or is it mostly a matter of providing guidelines now for kind of do-it-yourselfers?
Yeah, we're really kind of in the, you know, I think our approach is to provide some technical assistance, and we'll do a few pilot projects, as Katie mentioned, so people can kind of organize their own work parties in their neighborhood and maybe pay it forward to their neighbors. And we're doing our certification program so people can get the yard sign and kind of show off, you know, what they're doing.
Okay. Yeah, a couple of questions have shown up in chat. Okay. One is, have any commercial properties taken advantage of ocean-friendly gardens?
I know that in Huntington Beach, there is a ocean-friendly garden at one of the hotels that is close to the water. Can't remember the name of that hotel. Shorebreak Hotel, possibly. but they, Kai has worked on a couple commercial properties, right?
Yeah. Well, a lot of new development has to have some kind of stormwater requirement. But to get the native plant component and really make it an OFG, I think, I think the more of those we see are more like, public vacant lots that are like community beautification projects or schools.
Yeah.
Also,
to circle back to your question, where the program has been kind of dormant in the past couple of years, we're excited to start it, getting it going again. And the LA chapter has also been doing a couple ocean friendly garden events. So if you're closer to like LA or Torrance area, they're doing some things as well. There's also a new coordinator in Huntington Beach that's working on getting their program up and running. So we're hoping to have an ocean friendly renaissance starting. And we're mostly trying to give people the tools to do it themselves in their yard. And do more volunteer-based programs on like community projects and less like private like residences for when we gather up volunteers pretty much. Also, to get to the next question with D, there was a bench on one of Kai's slides. I believe you're talking about the one with the alternative lawn.
There's a little solar fountain I think they had up there. Yeah.
Yeah. They have like a little solar powered fountain going in there. So, and
is that one of the, things that you encourage is integration of solar?
I think that was just a bonus part there.
Yeah. For sure we'd encourage it. It's definitely not required. But I've had various like water features built in just to like provide that element and, like a bird bath or what have you. But yeah, I think the homeowner added that feature. So pretty cool.
When will this recording be posted?
I think that's a question for me.
Yeah.
Sometime this week, if you look on our YouTube channel, it should be posted. It sort of depends on the free time that I have. So these days, that means sometime this week usually.
Yeah.
Oh, and someone asked about a cistern versus a rain barrel, and I kind of left that out because there was a good discussion on last week's, the statewide CNPS talk on water harvesting the rain. So someone spoke about cisterns, but that's generally just a much larger water tank, and they're it's not as common to see, so it's a lot more expensive and takes up more space, and we think this storing water in the landscape is the most effective, cost-effective, and just the largest volume you can get is a bank it in the ground.
Mm-hmm. Also, that's a good segue into the artificial turf question. Artificial turf is not allowed in our ocean-friendly gardens criteria for a lot of reasons, and it's not allowed in LADWP's lawn replacement program anymore, I believe, because of a lot of reasons. I also, where do we start? artificial turf is like a giant sheet of plastic, so it promotes compaction in your yard. It'll be really hot. It doesn't have the natural evapotranspiration that real plants have. It also creates a lot of microplastic pollution. It's a giant source of microplastic pollution because all those little blades of grass, and if you put plastic sheeting underneath, if you put broken up tires underneath, all of that contributes to microplastic pollution and chemical leaching into the ground. Also, people say it's easier and less maintenance, but you still see people hosing it down with water, and it really holds smell. So if you have any dogs or dogs walking by that area, it's going to hold all of that smell in there, and you're not going to get any of the wonderful ecological benefits of having pollinator attracting plants and like three-dimensional depth to your garden.
Kathryn, those are all good points. Is there some way you would approach your Uncle Bob or something like that, who is insistent that he wants artificial turf and you're trying to gently persuade him that that's a bad idea?
Yeah, I would focus mostly on the user-oriented things. So like that it captures a lot of smell, that you you have to replace it every 5 to 10 years as well. That's a big maintenance thing that people don't think about. It breaks down and gets bleached in the sun and it looks really bad. And there's one more thing about that. And then also that it gets really hot. So it can make, like, if it's near an area of your house that you want to hang out in, it can make it very warm.
I think the point you brought up too, that people think, well, I don't have to water it, but it gets dirty enough to water it. So it can end up taking a fair amount of water to clean it.
And it's really hard too. You got to have like a compacted layer underneath it of, you know, road base. So unless you're putting some kind of cushion in there, it's not like a nice soft lawn alternative.
And weeds can come up through it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I just tell people, like, do you think there's enough plastic and concrete covering our landscape, or do we need more? And the beauty of the ocean from the gardens and gardening, landscaping with native plants is, you know, nature, we have the ability to influence just this small realm of our own, you know, home, and it's an opportunity to bring nature in regenerate, you know, the planet. So just more you know, artificial turf and is part of the problem, not the solution.
I think there's been just a lot of information about the health benefits of nature and having it right there in your yard. I mean, even if it's just a strip of grass or you know, better yet, plants. I mean, we're talking at the beginning about the marvelous smell to some of the native plants. So even if you have a small strip and you could plant, if we have I have a huge yard, but I have a small planter outside my living room, and I have the salvia spathiaceae growing there. And when I walk by, it's just so fabulous, you know, the smell. And it's just growing in like a 2 by 4 foot spot. I mean, it would grow even a smaller spot than that.
Or even like, yeah, like
flowers and everything.
You know, I had someone remark to me like, oh yeah, you told us that California fuchsia was going to be a hummingbird magnet, and boy, like, you know, they camp out on that on that plant. So I mean, yeah, it just brings a lot of you know, joy to people to see, like, you plant something and then, you know, things start happening with the butterflies and birds. And
I think it's really important to emphasize, you know, I was at a city council meeting and they talked about how, you know, we are only concerned, you know, you people, something the councilman said, only concerned about, you know, the plants. You have no concern for people. But it really is, having a healthy plant environment and healthy environment is really beneficial to people. Also, I wrote an article for the Land Conservancy of all places, and it was headlined Life-Friendly Gardens. And they said, their editor said, you need to change it to Wildlife-Friendly Gardens. I said, no. You know, I end up not being published because I said, no, I'm not going to change that. It's life-friendly because it's not just wildlife, but my dogs, myself, my kids, my mom. You know, having a natural environment is healthy for everybody.
I love that you coined that phrase, life friendly.
It's not my phrase. I can't take credit.
Okay. Well, that you use it, because I haven't heard it. And my DBA is future friendly landscaping, because the Contractors Association didn't like, you know, California Eco Design installation company for some reason. But you know, I thought the future friendly kind of incorporated all the different multiple benefits that you're talking about of, you know, we're not borrowing from the future to do this. And yeah, you have to take into account, like, you know, the drought was a way of getting our foot in the door for the stormwater aspect, but it's really like there's so many layer upon layer of benefits to this way of landscaping that, you know, I think you're absolutely right. It definitely, people have like a sanctuary, a place that's going to bring them relaxation. I think that's definitely going to help health if the more we build on that.
Definitely. Yeah. Also to touch on to touch on that, yeah, the life-friendly garden definitely is accurate. We often think of ourselves as being separate from nature and not a part of it. I think it's important to acknowledge that it's like we're not, humans and nature are not separate, but we're very interconnected and definitely have an opportunity to be interconnected.
And you don't need like a huge space to reconnect with nature, yeah. Right? So you can. So I appreciate the work the Native Plant Society is doing. And, you know, if people experiment with some of these techniques and find that, oh, you know, this plant does great in the, you know, in the rain garden, I'd love to, you know, we'd love to hear about it too and get your photos and see what you all are doing.
Yeah, also as a part of the Ocean Friendly Gardens program, we're trying to develop like local native plant lists that are like very reliable choices for landscaping. So it's not overwhelming for people to like go see like a just giant lists of plants. So we've made one for Long Beach, and like Kai said, if you find any plants that work great in your area, there is chapters in LA and in Orange County and in South Bay that I'm sure would love to hear about what's working in your area. To answer Bill's question real quick, did you say Torrance has an OFG program? I think South Bay might have an OFG program. The LA chapter definitely does. And they're just, they're a little bit more north in Santa Monica. And then Adela's question about a swale where half the water goes to the roof. Does that go to the water table? It probably depends on your yard and what your plants are utilizing. And other environmental benefits are still, you're still fostering like that microorganism biodiversity in your yard by making that water available to like all the little invertebrates that live in your soil. And you're still able to build habitat with that water. And if you have like a more dune-like environment, you can always find plants that work for that.
And Kathryn, maybe I'll add on to that. I think there's kind of a brackish water table that's more coastal that acts as a interference. It prevents the salt water from intruding further inland and making our freshwater wells salty. So the point of water infiltrating in, say, North Redondo is made more to be filling up that brackish water table that stands off the ocean.
I wanted to add, you mentioned about coming up with more narrow plant lists rather than hundreds and hundreds of plants. There is a CNPS has a program called Bloom California, where they've tried to pick out, a small number of plants that really like, you know, superstars in the garden that are still California native plants. So that's a resource for people, Bloom California, B-L-O-O-M. The other thing is you mentioned about people sending you photos, which is a good segue to remind people, as I did at the beginning, next month is our annual dessert potluck and photo sharing. We're accepting up-to-minute presentations, has to do with California native, but we're accepting photos, we're accepting original songs, cover songs that you change the words so it has paints and native plants, artworks, tapestries, whatever you want to bring, we encourage you. And so for the Ocean Friendly Gardens people, and everybody's welcome to join in. You don't have to be a member. So people could either bring their stuff, or even better yet, send an email to membership@sccnps.org, and then you can get a link. You can upload your pictures of your stuff or your pictures to we'll put everything on a Google Drive, but people could bring it to the event as well.
Do you have a link for that, or?
It will be on our website, and okay.
Yeah, I put the Bloom link in our chat, and Kathryn says they've got it linked on their resource website as well.
Yep.
It's a good one.
It's a good one. We have the Native Plant Parkway program linked on there as well, too.
Cool.
Now, Tony notes that we've got, there's regional plant lists also available from CalFlora, which tends to be, have a broader reach than Bloom. And in my experience, I prefer CalFlora, but maybe that's just me. It gets a bit more technical.
CalScape?
No, CalFlora, actually. CalScape is a good one too, but CalFlora is geolocated, plant locations, and you can get ranges from it and stuff like that. It's a good one.
Actually, I meant to say CalScape.
Yeah, it's a good one too.
But they're both, CalFlora's, yeah, that's more technical. But yeah, CalScape.
CalScape's a good one.
Well, thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, it's been delightful. So thank you very much. Yeah, and last questions. Oh, Karen says she lives in Gardena and she's been stealing ideas from the Long Beach Parkway program. So you're already making an impression, I guess.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, another local designer. Someone from the who's involved with the Native Plant Society has also helped develop those parkway plans. So
yeah, I helped a little bit with that. This is Chris.
Oh, okay. Get in touch with us. We'll leave our emails if you didn't catch that.
I can put both our emails in the chat as well.
Yeah.
Sure, why don't you put them in the chat? And Dee, I see that you missed some of the chat. So I do get a copy of that. Generally, I don't post it, but I can send a copy to you.
Okay, well, thank you, everybody. And keep planting native plants. This is the time. Time is now. Put some seeds out. Pull some weeds around those native plants that just come up on your own. I had a toyon plant come up in my yard. And it's on its own. Bird must have brought it. So.
And get ready for the rain.
Yeah. Thank goodness for the rain. It's going to be, should be really nice if we get some rain. Now is the perfect time. Get everything to grow. We can have some field trips. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you. All right. Also, Hermosa Beach, Greenbelt has a native plant program. Good to see. All right.
I'll have to check that out.
Everybody, sign out.
Thanks, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. That was great. We had 33 people online, which is reasonable. So
pretty good
turnout.
Yeah. Thanks for inviting us, Brent. Appreciate you hosting us.
It's our pleasure. Thank you, Kai.
All right.
Thank you, Kathryn.
Bye now.